what is real success for me? Is real success for me having the car or that house? Or is it in being able to play 10 years for the country and achieve certain number of goals and targets that I want to achieve? Experience is not about the number of matches you play. It's what you learn from each match. One of the things I learned with experience is that when you're in a good run, because it's become so much more competitive today, it's almost become harder for sportsmen actually to have a normal life. I guess when I speak with and work and interact with a lot of younger people, is they're not necessarily just coaching the cricketer, you're trying to coach the person.
So one of the immortal stories of Indian cricket is your partnership with BVS Lakshman in the 2001 Test Cricket Australia, Kolkata. We all know the number of runs you have scored, centuries you made. You know, double century, you made a century, India flipped the test match around, turned it around and said and won. I'm curious to know, in that long partnership that you all had, what was the conversation? What do you all, you know?
Not much, you know. I mean, I think we just kept reminding each other to stay in the moment. You know, not get too carried away.
No jokes, no songs, no...
not too much. I mean, we're not... It's a long time also, I can't really remember too much. But I just enjoyed batting with Lakshman because he's...
Many, many,
you know, the thing is, we'd batted a whole day for South Zone also once, you know, kind of before that. I kind of played a lot of my cricket with Lakshman. So it was really a good vibe. We kind of got along well. But in a sense, you know, once you got into that rhythm and that flow of that day, things seemed to click. And all we really had to do was not get too far ahead of ourselves and just remind ourselves that, you know, don't get too ahead of yourself. Just stay in the moment, stay focused, support and back each other up. And it clicked, yeah. I mean, it was one of those days, you know, I guess it's one of those days people, everywhere I go, I get asked this question. I think Lakshman does as well. Yeah. So it's a really special day to be a part of, because I guess in a lot of ways, you know, your career is more than that one day, but people remember you by that.
So fine, that partnership apart. Is there anything, you know, funny or memorable you remember from any of the long innings you had? You know, you end up thinking about it and saying, hey, you know, that's something.
I guess batting with Viru was always interesting, Viru. Right? Yeah, he was, because we were quite different in that sense, right? You know, I mean, and he'd be opening the batting and I'd kind of walk up to him, you know, when I'd come in, and I was generally quite thoughtful or might ask him a few too many questions. Okay, what's happening? What's the bowler doing? And you know, Viru would be probably whistling a tune or humming some tune and he'd say, just watch the ball and hit it. And it was just great advice, actually. It was a perfect kind of advice I needed, because I'd probably overthink it. Yeah. And, you know, he just gives me a simple advice of things. So I guess I would, if he was simplifying too many things and probably looking at me, he might think, no, maybe I need to think about stuff sometimes a little bit. And I would probably, from him, I would need to learn how to, you know, keep things simple and not overcomplicate things. So I think there's a lot that we can take from each other and we took from each other. So yeah, you know, I think some of the things that he could do on a cricket field were, you know, incredible. I remember this test match in Sri Lanka, and in one stage, I think Muralidharan put 6 or 7 fielders, I think, on the leg side. Yeah. And was bowling those bigs and we were in the middle and you know, he said, kahin pe bhi dalunga, offside mein hi marunga. And literally, I mean, and Muralidharan bowled it this far outside leg, and Viru went this way and hit him on the offside, and he smiled at Murali. So, I mean, it was great fun batting with all of them. I mean, there's so many, you know, they're phenomenal players. So it was great fun and learned so much. Yeah.
Sport is controlled. I mean, there's a universe.
Right. Yeah.
Where the laws are fixed and et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And sometimes there are loopholes which
exist
within laws. And people say, or a lot of sportspersons say, that look, I must get the competitive advantage. I'll give you an example.
Right.
You know, the underarm delivery bowled by Trevor Chapman.
Yeah.
Because Greg Chapman, his brother, said,
it
was not banned then. It was subsequently banned. But there is also another way of looking at it, you know, which is, I saw it first, Sir Garfield Sobers, 1966 test match in Bombay, one of the earliest matches I've seen. Budhi Kundran caught in the leg trap by Sobers. Umpire gives him out. Sobers says, no, I took it on the
bounce.
On bounce.
Yeah,
half volley. Calls him back, he makes 79.
Right.
G.R. Vishwanath, your hero, calling back Bob Taylor
right.
in 1979. You doesn't have to. The laws were clear.
Yeah,
the umpire gives you out, you go back.
Absolutely.
In your playing career, 2011, in England, you know, when you had a golden series, so to speak.
Yeah.
Ian Bell was called back, I think, at Trentbridge.
Correct.
So,
yeah.
Different interpretations for different sportspersons.
Yeah, and there always will be. It's not an easy one. It's hard to make a rule and say that, no, this is the... Each one will play it. Each one will play this game according to certain... the way they see it or the way they perceive the values. Like, for example, walking is a good example. You know, there were guys I know who walked. I mean, they said J.R. Vishwanath walked.
Yes.
There's a lot. There's a large part of his career. Adam Gilchrist walked. You know, from a personal point of view, I viewed the same situation slightly differently. I was never a walker. I can't claim to be a walker. It's a good place to say that. You know, I was not necessarily a walker, but I never believed in arguing a decision. You know, I've got my share of poor decisions in my career, and I respected that. And I said, look, there are days when it works for me as well. You know, I might get a close LBW that goes with me. And on the other day, I get a really inner edge that hits my pad and the umpire gives me out. And I just followed the rule wherein I said, look, I'm not going to argue the decision. I'm going to respect the fact that, you know, a decision has been made and I have to walk away from the playing arena without arguing it or without, I might get upset about it in the dressing room, but publicly, you know, not questioning the decision, because that's the way the game is played. The umpire's law in our game is always considered to be final. And of course, now you can review it.
Yes.
But for a large part of my career, you couldn't review stuff. So, you know, I think I respect the people who chose to walk when they knew they were out. Or in that sense, it's really each one has to find his own space in that, you know, in that thing. And you can't judge other people and say, oh, he's not doing it, so he's a bad guy. I think as long as you're following the rules. And, you know, I think obviously claiming bump catches when you know it is pretty obvious, something that you don't want to do. Yeah, these are the complex, I think, that's the challenges, I think, with sport. That's what makes it really interesting. You know, there's so much scope for, interpretation, and there should be, and there has to be. But in and around that, you can still show a level of fairness, a level of sportsmanship, certainly not cheat. So I think in and around that, you can certainly show a level of sportsmanship and balance.
So interestingly, you came out in favor of, when this debate was raging about Ashwin and Ross Butler and running what is no longer called Mankade.
So
now that's been revised.
And
you said, well, he's right.
Yeah.
You know, and the traditional kind of impression or the approach was, no, you can't do it. But actually, palpably, there's an advantage being taken by the
So basketball. So my issue with that is, and I think Ashwin did it in this tournament, you know, he warned Aaron Finch, I think.
Aaron Finch,
I would have liked, you know, just from a perspective, even coaching a lot of our under 19 guys, you know, I tell them, please just warn the guy first, you know, because a lot of times I feel that the batsman leaves the crease being not necessarily wanting to cheat. You know, it just sort of happens. Having said that, I can't judge someone who does it because he's well within the rules to be able to do that. A lot of times in the Ashwin example, I mean, I started seeing people talk about it as a character flaw, which is absolutely wrong. Ashwin's a fantastic guy and there's nothing wrong with him. It's not a judgment on him as a person. He's interpreting the rules in a way that he feels is the right way to interpret those rules. You know, and he's well within his rules to be able to do that. And you know, I think people can't, you know, just say, no, he's a bad guy for doing that, or he's wrong to do that. You know, you have to say, okay, in my opinion, maybe he could have done it slightly differently, but he's absolutely well within his rights to do it. You know, and I'm not making a moral science judgment or making a moral judgment on this issue. You might have a slightly different opinion on it, which is fine. I mean, you know, you can have like Ricky Ponting might have had a slightly different opinion to Ashwin this time on it.
It surprised many people.
Yeah, I mean, and Ashwin is purely entitled to have a very different opinion on it, and he could be right. It's one of those things where I think you can't actually have a black and white stance on. I think if you have a stance on it, you should recognize that other people might have a slightly different view on it.
Correct.
And respect that view.
And you know, both can coexist.
Both can coexist. You know, if somebody chooses not to run someone out and says, no, I don't believe in running someone out, the guys who choose to do the run out in terms of, you know, when the person leaves the crease, shouldn't say that, oh no, that's the wrong way to do it as well, because someone might have a slightly different take on it and say, no, I don't actually feel like, you know, doing it. So he's not wrong. So, you know, it works both ways. There are people who criticize the people who do it. And then I find there are people who are sometimes so strongly of the view that this should be done that they start criticizing the people who don't do it. You know, so and I think you just have, we have to learn to coexist in that space and say, okay, this is a rule. And I will sort of I can be somewhere in the middle on this.
Yeah.
And that's fine.
We've got now the DRS system which is coming.
Right.
Just about came in, I think.
Just, yeah, towards the back end,
back end. Do you rationalize it? You mentioned earlier that...
No, I think when you look at the DRS, I just think that it's really good.
Is it a good thing?
No, I think it's a good thing. I think it's a good thing. Because we are all looking for to make the right decisions. And if you have technology that's there today that can be used, then why not, right? I mean, I think it's made for a much more less fractious competition. You know, I think in the past, people would complain about umpiring all the time. So there's a lot of noise around the system, umpiring. When we go to this country, umpires are bad. You know, I got a bad decision. You know, today, I think with at least with technology, with the help of neutral umpires, with the help of DRS, we can focus on the game and not attribute results to noise. Okay, I lost because this was wrong. That was unfair. You know, as long as we can use technology in the right way, then I'm all for it, to be honest.
So I'd like your take on this. And this is, in a sense, kind of sensitive and complex. But today, more and more sports and politics is getting intertwined. We've had, I mean, it's been in the US, you know, Blackfish, the Olympics, and then Muhammad Ali was a great campaigner for black rights, not going to war. But now Black Lives Matter are taking the knee. What's your overview on the situation? Because more and more sports persons enjoy a very high pedestal in public life.
Correct.
And therefore, ordinary people look up to them and say, kya bol raha hai, iska opinion kya hai?
Again, I really think it's a very individual thing. You know, I think putting pressure on sportsmen to have political views or political thoughts is wrong. I mean, and there are people who might have those views, might have those thoughts, might have a point of view. And them expressing it is not wrong. But again, I think there are people who may be uncomfortable to use that medium or that space to have, you know, very strong political views. You know, sportsmen are not necessarily, you know, like I said, they play the sport and they'd like to be good role models and good examples for people from the sport that they're playing. You know, the sport gives them the platform to be able to be good role models and to have young boys and girls watch and observe them and learn from. They might say that, look, I want to be a role model in terms of the way I play my sport or the way I conduct myself. It's not, I don't want to be a role model in terms of the political point of view.
Correct.
And that's fine, you know, and I think people should be allowed to be given that space. You cannot pressurize people to have, you know, no, this, you should have a political view. You should take a stand on this or you shouldn't take a stand on this. And there will be others who are slightly more politically inclined who might feel that this is a platform for them to do it and they will do it.
That's so, fair income.
That's absolutely fair income to them. We've got to be careful that we don't start creating environments where we pressurize people to do things. You know, and just because they do it because it's the right thing to do. We've got to be careful with that. I think, of course, sport has a great opportunity. And by the very nature of sport, right, when you have, I think, you know, it's the beauty of the sport in India. And I think that's one of the great things I love about playing sport in India. It's, you know, it's been a great reflection of our society in a lot of ways, right? There's no, you know, I mean, we've had people from many religions play the sport in the same team. We've had people from many cities play. Today, you've got so many kids from small towns in India, different socioeconomic backgrounds, all playing the sport, different educational backgrounds playing the sport together, being great friends, competing, winning matches for the country, playing for the country, representing the country together. I think that in itself is, you know, a fantastic example for people to follow, that you can succeed being from different places. You can get along being from different views and different thoughts and completely different upbringings. And that in itself is a great example, you know, and that's, and when, you know, sporting organizations work to a slightly more fairer system in that thing, whether it's through age fudging, whether it's through selections, giving of opportunities to everybody, trying to ensure that, you know, we're creating facilities and opportunities for people from all over the boys and girls from every section of society to be able to succeed. I think you're there in itself, you're, you know, that's a great lesson.
But now you're dealing with a lot of youngsters who must be given certain benchmarks. A lot of them may be feeling, you know, will I become a victim of politics, intense competition, favoritism, not from the, wherever they come from. So to allay those fears, what is your approach?
Oh, it's hard to allay those fears in the sense that I think certain amount of insecurities and doubts are there in most of these guys. But I think if you can show them that at least in the environment that you're working in or that you're creating in, it's going to be, you're going to be trying to be as fair as possible and create an environment where there's not a lot of fear of failure. That's really the best you can do. I mean, it's a very competitive environment in India, and I think that's the biggest challenge that we're going to face going ahead, is that there's so many talented kids in India and so many good players that there are going to be some people who are very, very good players who are not going to get an opportunity to play. That's hard, and there's nothing you can do about it. Sometimes it's just bad luck, bad timing. You still have to be truthful to your purpose, which is try to be the best person you can be, you know, and not get swayed by a lot of these other things, because it's just unfortunate. You know, sometimes it's, I mean, there's so much of talent in India. Only 11 people can play. Yeah.
There's a lot of buzz about, or this word is now used very commonly and profusely, which is communication. Communication channels. Yeah. As a coach, you think that this is really the key now, and because it becomes so intense, even in sports at the junior level.
Yeah. No, I think communication is important in everything. I think also a lot of the young people today, like I said, it can't really be about, you know, just teaching them, oh, this way and this is the only way to do things. You've really got to communicate with the younger kids today, boys and girls, and really get a sense from them where they are at, and then sort of try and coach them or guide them. Because, you know, at least I find from my own personal experience with them that they're respectful of you, but they're not going to blindly follow you. You know, I think in the past, we probably would just blindly follow. Kids aren't going to just blindly follow you today because they have a lot of knowledge and information, right? They're not going to just, you know, do what you tell them to do. So you've got to make them almost partners in it. Otherwise, you want them to do certain fitness stuff or you want them to do certain drills, you've got to definitely explain it a lot more than saying, just do this. You know, it certainly doesn't work. Or at least my experience has been that.
You know, this whole thing of integrity versus gamesmanship it's not necessarily a black and white situation in sport.
Yeah. So again, like in the people talk a lot about sledging and things like that. Even in that area, I think, you know, a certain amount of healthy banter or competitiveness is fine. And it's you know, it's great fun. But when you start getting into people's personal space, or when you try doing it with malice, or when you start, there is a certain level of racial undertones in some of this stuff, then I think it's wrong. You know, then I think you're bordering, then you're going along a side of almost cheating. If it's in good humor, if it's in good spirit, then, you know, then I think there has to be a human element to the game as well, right? Yeah. It can't just be played by robots, and it's not. And people get competitive. They're playing for their countries. The matches get tight. They get, you know, and emotions will come out. Otherwise, we'll not see the best out of people. If there's no emotional connect.
It's not robotic.
Yeah. And unless they completely commit themselves to playing the game or the sport, you'll not see great performances. So when you do that, sometimes there is a chance that it might, you know, sway a little bit or go a little bit across the line. That's fine. I think we all have to accept that. But, you know, when it goes too far is when you need to then go back to the fact and understand what is your role and responsibility in the whole thing.
So you've got two young boys who are also playing sport
and
cricket. And is this something that you discuss with them, the ethics of sport, growing up into a game? There's a certain, I'm sure they'll read about the way you played the game. And they might have questions to ask.
My children are quite young at the moment. Yeah. So, But I think what's really important is for them to know that, you know, their dad was certainly not perfect, and that their dad never, you know, their dad had a lot of these questions. Sometimes I still don't have answers to a lot of this stuff. There are dilemmas in your own mind. You know, you talk about this simple thing we spoke about, the run out thing.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't know if like I'm completely clear on where I am on it. It's okay to be that. And I think as you grow and as experience will teach you certain things, your own life experiences will teach you things. Yeah, so I think for my own children, I don't necessarily want them to be me. You know, I want them to be themselves. I think that's the most important thing. And they have to live their lives from their own experiences, their own value systems, their own, the way they see the world, and be open to it. I think one of the things Vijita and me would love to be able to do is for them to really be exposed and be open to various views and thoughts, and then be able to make their own decisions, you know, and not force them into some kind of thinking.
What is the role of a captain, as you see it? Should he be conceptual? Should he be, this is the way I see it, and I've got great clarity of thought, and therefore I know what I'm doing. And lift people who are, you know, some fine performer suddenly hits a trough.
Yeah. You know? So I just think in terms of leadership, I think leadership's also changed today. And we talked about the millennials and we talked about young people and all that. I think the dictatorial form of leadership or the authoritarian form of leadership's honestly, in my opinion, a bit outdated. You need to be able to carry people along. You need to be able to lift people along. So in the past, I think, you know, information was something, or knowledge was something that was not many people had. And then they had the power. Today, I mean, I think with so much of information and knowledge around, everybody seems to have that knowledge and information. You're not special because you have some information, because everyone in your team will probably have more, and some will probably have more information than you. It's just about what you do with that information and how can you bring everyone's information or everyone's knowledge, everyone's skill together harmoniously to be able to achieve something. So I really think that, in my opinion, leadership's really about, like you said, it has to be a bit consensual. It has to be about, you know, bringing that group's collective knowledge or collective influence, collective intelligence to the fore for the best, you know, for the best result.
So as a coach or as a captain, there's somebody who may be a great player, but is perhaps not having such a great influence on the rest of the team.
Right.
Or if you're a mentor on the rest of the youngsters, what would be your approach?
So I think one of the important things in most teams is to recognize the fact, I think, that there are different individuals in a team and everyone brings a lot of value to that team. But in and around that, there have to be certain sort of non-negotiable rules that people need to buy into or need to agree to be, that are, these are non-negotiables and we all will follow them. And irrespective of whether you're a star player or you're not, you're a young, inexperienced player coming up through the ranks, these are certain things that we will follow. If you get everyone to buy into those things, and then when people don't do that, then you can question them about that and you need to question them about that. And if it goes to a point where people just don't seem to buy into that philosophy, then you're almost better off cutting your losses. But in and around that, I found that, you know, it doesn't really happen. I generally find that, especially in sport, a lot of the star players are also actually willing to be the ones who, they get there because they have certain, you know, values, they have certain ethics, they have certain ways in which they play the game. The way they approach their own cricket is a great role model or an example for other people. So I think having that broad framework of non-negotiable rules is really important, but giving people space in that as well. You know, in that you have to give people space for individuality.
Can't be my way or the other.
No, it can't be. Yeah, and you can't have too many rules in place because individuality also has to come in. You know, a certain amount. I think the more experience you get, the more you play the game. After some time, you understand yourself better than anyone else. And I think giving people who have that experience or who understand themselves better, give that a certain amount of freedom, you know, in terms of their own preparation for their own game. So, for example, you can't be too strict about, you know, this is the only way to practice, or this is the only time to practice, or this is the only, this is the amount of fitness that you have to do. Yes, you have some broad guidelines. These are basic requirements. But over and above that, some freedom you've certainly got to give.
Yeah. Sport is a great level. I mean, you may come from the most privileged background.
Yeah, absolutely.
Make you a successful sports person.
Totally.
Or you may come from a very humble background and reach.
As long as we're given the opportunity. So that's a great thing also now. I think the money in the sport is for me, you know, people say that, no, there's a lot of money in the sport. It's become very this. I always tell them, look at the other side of it. You know, the money in the sport has allowed us to be able to invest that money in small towns and villages and cities today, yeah, where there are basic facilities. Cricket's a game which, without facilities, you can't succeed. You know, you can play as much as you want on the road. You know, you can play in the street. You'll not become an international cricketer, you'll not be able to become a first-class cricketer if you continue to just keep playing on the road. Yeah. You know, you have to get to a proper coaching or a net or at some stage, whether it's 12 or 13 in your life, and you need those facilities. And money allows these facilities to be taken to down and down, and, you know, younger kids. So then finances doesn't become a barrier from playing the sport. And we are still far away from that. I still think that we can get even better. We should be aiming to get better, where we should be able to say that, you know, finances should never become a barrier to be able to play the sport. A large part of the success of cricket has been that we've been able to take a large part of the society along, but we can be still better at it, and we should strive to be better at it.
But do you think that there needs just to dwell on the money aspect, and, you know, 18, 20, 22 year olds now coming into really big money.
Yeah.
So that really cool. Apart from the mentoring, there needs to be somebody, some like a trust where the money is kept and they grow a little older. Is that too dictatorial?
That's too dictatorial, I think. I know it all sounds nice, but, you know, I think people are 18, they're adults. I think it's about education. I think you have to educate them that the risks of having this money, the wrong decisions you can take when you're 18 and to you're sort of that age, the choices you can make, when you could reflect on those choices at 32 and realize, oh, maybe that wasn't great choices or great use of the money that I had at that point of time. Because sport is also, as much as it's not, there's no guarantees in sport. Right? You can have great contracts for 2 or 3 years and then have nothing after that.
Very short-lived career.
It could be. Yeah, it could be a very short-lived career. So I think it's a lot about education. I think where we need to ramp up is education in terms of guiding a lot of these people is that, you know, what are the options that they have at that age and how should they be looking at this over the longer term future? And examples, I think we have great examples, I guess, in the system who we can learn from and whom we can learn both the good side of things and sometimes where people have gone wrong, you know, and use that as examples.
Would you say that the dressing room is like a microcosm of our national life? The diversity of the whole country
is actually
found in the...
In one of the under-19 teams that I was coaching, is just a change from, say, the time I played under-19 in 1990 or 89, 90 when I played. You know, most of us came from sort of the big 4 or 5 metros.
Yeah.
They were the odd boys who came from outside of the metros, you know. If I were to look at the team, under-19 team now, you'd find 2 or 3 boys coming from the metros. Everyone else is from outside.
Yeah.
I think just in the last 30 years, you've just seen how the country has changed. So, I mean, just you don't have to be in a big city today to succeed. And I think that's reflective, I think, of our nation as well, right? I think we're seeing...
Richer roles.
It's totally. The talent we have, the talent pool has increased to a large extent. And it's only going to get better and better. You know, I think we're only going to see more and more of this. So, it's you know, that's I think, fantastic. And that's, like I said, it's reflected in our dressing room. Yeah, it's phenomenal.
So, I want... You know, this is also an interesting part we can listen about the dressing room. So, while it is there, it's a microcosm of our life. And therefore, there's great camaraderie because you're playing for a common cause.
Yeah.
But there's also a lot of internecine competition because people are playing for their own careers. And ultimately, it's very different individuals. You know, there will be clashes, ego clashes, friends, or those who are not so friendly end up becoming very thick friends over a period of time or the other way around, etc. Yeah. What is the dynamic of a dressing room?
In a good dressing room, I think you do recognize that you're competitors as well as people who lift and pick each other up. You know, I think that's the very important thing because, you know, I always say this, I wouldn't have been the batsman I was if I didn't have the privilege of playing with Tendulkar, Lakshman, Ganguly, Sehwag, Gambhir. You know, they in turn, in some kind of way, were also, I guess, competitors for me, but they were also people who challenged me and pushed me. I mean, I could learn so much from them or watching them bat or being inspired by their performances to become the best version of myself. You know, so I think in that situation, it's how you view it. If you just see them as competitors, then I think you view it wrongly. But if you see them as people who can actually get the best out of you and push you and challenge you to get the best out of yourself, then I think that's a better way to look at that. So dressing rooms, obviously, you know, they have their challenges. It's high, you know, there are times
when... It's also high-strung.
It can be because it's very competitive. You're trying to do the best you can. There are times when, you know, you're not necessarily going to agree with everyone on a lot of things. But as long as I think in good dressing rooms or good environments, as long as you agree that it's not necessarily about liking everyone that is in that dressing room, but as long as you respect everyone and as long as you understand that we're all in this together for a common goal, we're all in this to try and, you know, win that particular series or do the best we can for India, you know, that's, I think, it. Surrounding yourself with people who you agree with all the time not necessarily gets the best out of you.
Correct.
In fact, you need to surround yourself with people who, who challenge you and push you. Yes, some of them might agree with you. Some of them might not agree with you. And that's not important. But what's important is, you know, are they getting the best out of you? Are you as a group and a collective better having different opinions and different views and coming from different backgrounds than you are with the same people all the time? And it's generally been proven that a variety of opinions or a variety of thought works better in most situations.
What would take your mind off lingering kind of problem?
I found books actually.
You're not a party animal. So.
Yeah, so I found books a really good way to do it. So I wasn't much of a reader even when I was in school, and it was through college, you know, I started picking up books and I started reading books. And I always tell people, I actually started getting into a reading habit simply because I found that books, you know, helped me in a way to take me away from, like, you know, thinking about the cricket too much. When I was outside of the cricket, if you're just sitting and doing nothing, then you tend to think about the cricket too much and you tend to drain yourself out. And I found that even when I was watching TV, I would be doing that. So I think books was an easier way for me to kind of take my mind off the game.
Did you ever have a deep fear of failure?
I think I had a pretty good relationship with failure. I didn't take it too personally. I kind of didn't see it too much of a reflection of myself as a person. So I tried to sort of I mean, I'd like to believe I had a pretty decent relationship with failure. I don't think I was stressed by worrying about failing. I mean, I failed and it disappointed me and I felt bad about it and all that. But I didn't go in being scared to fail. No, I didn't avoid things because I was worried I would fail. No, I would probably push myself,
yeah,
you know, wanting to do things. And then, of course, I'd be disappointed if I failed, and I would get nervous before I played matches, and you know, that never changed right through my career. I always thought as a kid, when I played 50 test matches, oh, I won't get nervous. When I play 100, I won't get nervous. You know, till my last test match, believe me, I got nervous. So that never really changed.
Any particular bowler or bowlers put some fear in you?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of them. You know, a lot of them. I think I played some great bowlers, yeah. But so, as a fast bowler, I think someone like a Glenn McGrath was someone who I think challenged me the most, because he really, you know, I think he was really consistent and he challenged the knowledge of my off stump. So I always felt that one of the good things about my game or strengths of my game was that, you know,
off stump was.
And I could leave balls well, and so I could get out of a difficult period when things were not going my way. I could fight my way out of it, you know, defend, leave, and then hopefully tire the bowlers out, and then, you know, then sort of reinforce myself on them. But with McGrath, I generally found that his line, and he came so close to the stumps, and you know, sort of, he got that extra bounce. Generally found that he challenged my off stump more than other people. Not to say that like someone like Sean Pollock did the same, or Alan Donald was a fantastic bowler, Wasim Wakar, Ambrose, and yeah, I mean, Dale Steyn, phenomenal. Jimmy Anderson, all of these guys were terrific. On a spinner level, I think Muralidharan was someone who was a brilliant bowler. He was fantastic in the way he spun the ball, especially when he had that dusra from around the wicket. He, you know, spun it. He was a terrific bowler. And Warney was a great bowler as well. So, yeah, not one. At various stages in my career, there were many people that you knew they were very good. And if you were not at the top of your game, they were going to get you out. And they did.
Are there some guiding principles that have shaped your cricketing life and your personal life?
I mean, I just say, like, I've always striven to get the best out of myself in terms of my cricket. Let the process guide the way. Be honest to who I am. Try to be myself and recognize that, you know, I'm only a custodian of the game for a short period of time, and I need to try and leave the game in a better place when I leave it. Yeah, and I think to ensure that I, to the best of my ability, follow the rules and regulations.
What are the things that have paid you rich dividends?
Just being honest to myself and honesty to the work, hard work. I just think being honest to who I am, accepting who I am in some ways, the good and the bad, and recognizing that, to achieve something, you've got to work hard for it. And, you know, you've got to do the best you possibly can. I think that's been important.
You actually trained harder and worked harder in your early 30s, more than what you did in your 20s.
Correct.
Just to be up there in the fitness.
Yeah, you had to, right? You had to do that, because I just found that, just from a fitness perspective, you know, to be able to do the same, hit the same benchmarks as an athlete, just became harder and harder as I got along. And I think things also changed. I think coming into the Indian team earlier, in the early part of my career, there wasn't a lot of focus on the fitness side of things. But as I started finishing, you could see the trend was changing, and Indian cricket was changing, and there was a much more focus on fitness. And today it's really phenomenal. I think when you look at the Indian team today, you think that, you know, for a large part of it, they're as fit as anyone else in the world. And you know, it's not only the Indian team, but even if you look at a lot of our under-19 boys and boys who come to the NCA, we still a work in progress, but certainly a long way away from where we were a decade ago.
Paradigm shift by Virat Kohli, I think, inspired.
Totally, yeah. I mean, I think he's inspired by example, right? The way he leads by example. You know, I think the way he's pushed himself, the way the energy that he brings to the field, that's become just a great role model for a lot of young boys and girls today watching, who just look at that and say, oh, these are the standards we need to set, because that's what our hero is doing. And that in itself, you're being a leader. You're being a change maker by just doing something really well.
So these last two or three questions which I have, which I wanted to actually ask you at the start, but I'm going to finish with that. One is, what's been, you know, this is a very reflective period, this lockdown, and you know, what we've been through this COVID year. What's it been like for you?
I mean, I think the lockdown period for people like us has not been okay. It's, yeah, other than the small discomfort of having to stay at home and wear a mask most
people
of the time.
Have suffered a lot.
Yeah, so it's, you know, I mean, for what we've had to go through, it's been very, very, this lockdown, you know, so far hasn't really affected us. But there are other people who it's affected in really tough ways. And you know, so it's been, I guess, in a way, it makes you just feel lucky. And it just makes you feel grateful and gives you that sense of, you know, that I'm privileged and hopefully I can do stuff to make things life and a lot easier for other people who probably don't have that same opportunities that I have.
And you've got two young boys at home, 15 and 13?
15 and 11, yeah.
15
and
11.
Yeah, yeah.
And to harness them, they must be...
Yeah, it's been... Yeah, it's been tough for them. I mean, I guess having to study online and school, and so they've learned some skills. Yeah. They've, you know, but no, it's not been easy for children because they've had to spend a lot of time indoors. You know, a lot of time on front of screens. A lot of their sporting activities, a lot of their interactions with friends has been reduced to a large extent.
Not easy for teachers or parents.
Yeah, it's been tough for everyone, and I think how this is going to affect us, we'll probably only know when people do some research on this 10 years down the line.
That was splendid.
Thanks, Aaron.
Wonderful speaking.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Aaron.